Why don't you tell us about, let's start off with economic mobility. So economic mobility is thought of as, let's say I have a kid whose parents are in the bottom fifth or the bottom fourth of the American income distribution. Mm-hmm. What does that kid's life end up looking like in different parts of the country?
Right. So I guess to start off, if you just take a child at the bottom fifth of the, whose parents are in the bottom fifth of the income distribution, and you ask what is the odds that they grow up to reach the top fifth of the income distribution, that's about 8 or 9% in the United States for recent cohorts. But as you alluded to, the odds of going from the bottom to the top of the income distribution vary dramatically depending on where that child grew up. So, for example, if that child grew up in Atlanta or Charlotte or areas of the South or the Rust Belt, you see rates of upward mobility of about 4% in contrast to that national average of 8 or 9%. But if they had grown up in Salt Lake City or Sacramento, places on the West Coast or the Midwest, you see rates of upward mobility in excess of 12%. And so there's dramatic differences in the extent to which kids are rising up from disadvantaged backgrounds to reach that sort of American dream or those upper regions of the income distribution.
So how quickly does a kid from Salt Lake City start looking like a kid from Atlanta?
So if you take a child that moves, say, from Atlanta to Salt Lake City, and you look at their outcomes later in life based on the age of the child at the time they moved, what you find is that the earlier they move to Salt Lake City, the better the higher their incomes are in adulthood. Every year they spend growing up in Salt Lake City relative to Atlanta, they pick up about 4 percentage points of the difference in the outcomes of people who spent their entire lives growing up in Atlanta versus Salt Lake City.
Can you tell us a bit about moving to opportunity?
Sure. So back in the mid-1990s, Department of Housing and Urban Development conducted this moving to opportunity experiment, which gave families the opportunity to move from public housing projects to a Section 8 voucher program that allowed them to choose basically a unit to rent at a subsidized rate with a Section 8 voucher.
There were three types of people, right? So there was a control arm where nobody got, where they didn't get anything, an arm in which they just got normal Section 8 housing vouchers, right, which are mm-hmm. aid that enables poor people to actually have their rent paid for by HUD. And then there were specially limited Section 8 housing vouchers which said you could only use them if you moved to a low enough poverty area, right? So they were comparing different treatments, right?
Yeah, and the experimental group that got this requirement, they were required to use their Section 8 voucher in a census tract that had a low poverty rate. They were also provided with counselors to help them kind of manage that process of finding a unit in a place that they may not be as familiar with relative to standard Section 8 vouchers, which tend to be used in higher poverty neighborhoods. And so the goal here was to, the goal of the moving to opportunity experiment was to kind of incentivize families to move into quote unquote better neighborhoods with lower poverty rates. And so we went back to the data and looked at the outcomes of these children who were young when their families got these vouchers and these opportunities to move to better neighborhoods. And what we found was quite striking, but consistent with some of our other work, that there were large differences between the experimental group and the control group, on the order of upwards of 30% increases in a child's earnings for children who were less than 12 years old at the time their families got this voucher to move to a better neighborhood.
That's absolutely amazing. And it just shows the value of having sort of longer term horizons for evaluating this. It also goes along with one of the most important hypotheses about cities today, which is that it's an old idea, it's associated with Alfred Marshall, it's associated with Jane Jacobs then 60 years later, that in really well-functioning cities, the mysteries of the trade become no mystery but are, as it were, in the air, as Marshall put it. And it's very much this idea that, cities when they work well are places that make us smarter by being around other smart people.